Hi, my name is Alexander Richter. I'm a technical director for visual effects, animation, and games. And if you're new to the channel, that's exactly what we tackle here. Today, what I want to talk about is Avatar 2, The Way of Water, and my contribution as a technical director to this movie. Welcome to Bangkok, Thailand. A few days ago, I had the chance to watch the movie Avatar 2, The Way of Water in the cinema, specifically on a Screen X projection. And if you're not familiar what this is, I wasn't too. So it's basically a normal projection with two projections on the side, so you can basically watch the movie in your peripheral vision. And it creates this kind of involvement where you are dragged into the movie much more deeper. And it's an interesting experience, but comparable with stereoscopy, which I'm not the biggest fan of. I remember Avatar 1 and The Hobbit was much more kind of dragging you into this world and just giving you the depth that you wanted from this environment. So I generally would recommend, if you have to decide between the two, go for stereoscopy. But if you want to try something new, ScreenX is definitely an experience. So what did I do on the Avatar 2, The Way of Water movie? So my contribution as a technical director was mostly in the pipeline side. We specifically focused on modeling and the motion capture data. You're probably familiar that most of Avatar 2 is created in a motion capture environment, and that is created in LA and processed at Weta FX in Wellington in New Zealand. And since I was working for Weta FX, our job was basically getting this data and bringing it into the digital world, bringing it on the avatars, so they move like the actors move, and so they can translate the information from the actor to the avatar that you finally see in the movie. And of course, all the rest, of course, the most important thing in the second movie is the water, so the FX part and the naturality of all things. For me personally, also something that doesn't happen every day is to be proud to be part of a project, even though my contribution was very small, you know. I was working on this project for 1 year in the pipeline directing capacity. So this means I was helping with the modeling department and the motion capture department, specifically the transition from the LA motion capture data to the digital world, basically. And I was writing scripts, I was fixing scripts, doing support and all the things. And at the end of the day, my contribution compared to all the people that were working there was very, very small. Even like in the credits, you have to literally search me. But nevertheless, it's kind of an interesting experience to work on a movie that was worth your time. And even though it's not a perfect movie, it's not the best movie I've ever seen, it's always great to work on a project that you're proud of, you think is well done, and you think there was passion behind. So I think that is definitely one of the few takeaways from this project itself. So what were the skills involved to work as a technical director in the pipeline capacity on Avatar 2? My main focus was actually Python. I was looking into scripts, I was fixing scripts, I was looking into Maya scenes, which is not the same Maya as you are familiar with, because if you work for this kind of companies like WeatherFX, ILM, or Disney, they have a lot of different programming going around in Maya, they have a different API, they use a different scene explorer, different file formats and so on. So it is kind of a relearning. So it's not just Python, it's also understanding how the pipeline and the structure of a specific company and of organization works. And of course, of this project, how the naming conventions and so on. So what I did most of my time was, of course, meetings to talk about what's the next problem, looking into tickets, fixing tickets, looking into scripts, looking in how can I solve the problem that the artist has with the specific scene or character, and of course developing new scripts. So sometimes the artist would like to have something that is currently not there, something that makes his or her life easier. So my job was to figure out a concept and then talk with this person and to make sure that to deliver something that they actually need. And that is basically what I did. So if you summarize it, a pipeline technical director job is most of the time a programming job. It's very similar. You do code reviews, you do coding, you have typical meetings talking about structure. And even in some companies like Weta FX, we use Scrum to organize, you know, priorities, to organize how long it will take, which is an interesting concept. It can be a little bit theoretical at the end of the day, but it can also help you to develop your own kind of structure in a small team organization. In terms of working on a big project like Avatar 2, I think one of the misconceptions a lot of people have is that you are so engrossed into the project that you have your fingerprints everywhere, basically. But at the end of the day, specifically if you work on a more software directing side, you don't really are involved into the project. You, of course, you see sometimes a few shots, you open maybe a scene in Avatar, but you're not really working on Avatar itself. You're supporting the artists who are working on it. So this means you have to kind of focus more on the work, on the day-to-day challenges, than really on the big project. So if your goal is to work on the next Pixar movie or Disney movie or ILM Marvel movie, then important to know is that the movie itself, depending on your contribution, which can be very small, can be unimportant at the end of the day. The most important thing that kind of excites you is, of course, having a great idea behind, you know, having a great project. This is kind of a general excitement. But the day-to-day excitement is about your team, is about the work you do, is about if you can learn something, have developed new skills, and so on. So I think that is also important. So, of course, working for a company like WetaFX, the most important and the best parts were actually for me learning a lot new things, because it's surrounded by the biggest talents in the industry. So constantly being challenged how to do things, seeing a different approach. You know, we do code reviews if you go into programming, for example. But of course, if you would do artistic work, you will do artistic reviews. And the other part is learning about how much responsibility everyone can take. So this is actually something I learned is probably my favorite thing in working with highly professional people, is they take things very seriously and they take the responsibility. So a lot of times when I was working in smaller companies, a typical situation was actually that if I had a problem or someone had a problem, the responsibility and the problem was pushed away to the side, which means either it was pushed away until a later time when it exploded, or it was pushed away. It's someone else's fault. Oh, it's this department's fault. So it's kind of like, you know, went around in the departments, in the company, until it either was ignored or tackled by someone who really like took the time for it. While if you work in really great environments like WetaFX and pretty sure Pixar and Disney, the responsibility everyone takes, if you have a question, if you have a problem, if you like, you know, copy them into a ticket, into an email, a lot of people just take pride in helping you out, finding the solution. They feel like they are part of this group. And you get this situation where you have a problem and you have a question for someone who maybe knows the answer or at least has a hint. And suddenly you get this reply of thoughtful, responsible kind of comment where you're like, oh, you really, really helped me to solve it, or you even helped me to solve it. And I think that is my favorite thing. My least favorite thing working as a technical director in big companies like WetaFX is probably the closeness of it all. So basically, if you work in a company that is established for many years, there will be a lot of overrides. It will not be off-the-shelf products. You know, even if you work in Maya, it will not be the typical Maya with the typical outliner, the data format that you're used to know. Even the API is completely different. So that can be very challenging, because there is a lot of old information, maybe bad documentation. It's not something you can just Google. There are no forums around, there are no tutorials around. The documentation is maybe sometimes not good because it is an older documentation or never done. It is inside the company, so it's an intra wiki. And I think that is the biggest challenge sometimes, of understanding how things work, being reliant on other people's help, on experienced leads. And that's something feels that I would rather sometimes figure out the solution myself, but it can be sometimes impossible because it was a decision made like 10 years ago, maybe on the Lord of the Rings, and now this is the way they do it, but doesn't maybe make sense, or it's not clear enough. So you cannot just figure it out yourself. Sometimes you have to ask someone. I think that is the biggest challenge sometimes, is not having the information at your disposal and also kind of trying to understand the concept and ideas of a smaller group instead of something like, you know, if you create off-the-shelf products, it has to be broadly understood, it has to be created for basically the average person who uses the product. And I think this disconnect can be a challenge sometimes. So you're probably wondering, how can you work on the next Avatar? How can you work on the next Marvel movie at ILM, at FX? And I think the key elements to get to a situation that I got is basically to be bold, to apply for jobs, even if you don't feel 100% you are kind of, you know, skilled enough for them. That's what happened with me. So after I finished Monsters at Work, I felt like, okay, I stepped up in my game, but I definitely didn't felt like I'm a Weta FX level or ILM level. But I saw a post on LinkedIn about job opportunities, so I applied for actually 4 jobs, and I got 2 interviews and got hired at the end of the day and worked on Avatar 2. So being bold and applying, even though I actually didn't thought I would get the job, was the first step to get there. Of course, the other, you have to get your skills in order. So you have to have skills that Weta FX, ILM, Pixar find interesting, which means on one side, you should be on their level. You should create art or technical solutions that feel like Weta FX will do the same, Pixar will do the same, but also you should create something that aligns with what they do. If you want to become a lighting artist or a lighting technical director, you should create lights that Pixar will use. You should work with renderers that Pixar or ILM will use if they're not their own renderers, for example. So it's basically stepping up your game, but also aligning with their priorities, with their kind of projects. So at the end of the day, it's not just aligning your skills, but also looking at what kind of skills are they looking for, what kind of projects do we work on. So being aware of what they do, being aware of how you can help them specifically. I think if you can align that, this can take months or even years, I think you get the best shot of it. So it's not something you can do spontaneously, like decide tomorrow I want to work for Rockstar Games or ILM. It's more something that you have to develop in terms of your skills, you have to develop in terms of your interests, but then also have to laser focus and decide, okay, I want to work for this company, what do they need and how can I deliver that one? And at the end of the day, you should always choose something that you enjoy, that you would do in your free time. And if you can do that, you just kind of build up your career slowly. And I think that is my last advice, is time seems like, you know, running fast. You want things instantly, on demand, basically. But a lot of times, and this applies here too, it took time to get to the level of Weta FX. And it didn't fail that I was there when I was hired, but there were education that I did to get there. I worked in other companies and other projects that kind of get me there. I created my open source pipeline, which definitely played a role in this hiring situation. I applied by learning how to do interviews, how to do applications, and so on. So there's like a lot of elements. And of course, something that's maybe not as aware, if you apply for these bigger companies, they always ask for recommendations. So your old colleagues, your old leads and supervisors. So if I wouldn't have, I think, 4 supervisor leads who would recommend me, I don't think I would have gotten this job. So this is also something you cannot just snip your finger Thanos style and suddenly you have this job because you're so skilled. They also look for someone who is compatible, who can work with others, who has a good reputation, and that takes time. So I think if you really want to work for Weta FX, ILM, Pixar, and you want to work on the next movie that you think will give you the interesting challenge, interesting project, interesting team, you have to follow being bold, leveling up your skill, being laser focused, and at the end of the day, just deciding what you enjoy and build a reputation and a portfolio basically over time. Thank you very much for joining. I hope you enjoy Avatar: The Way of Water, and I will see you on the next video. Check out my website alexanderrichtertd.com if you're interested in more content like articles, masterclasses, and coaching opportunities to work successfully in the industry. Bam, 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 bam.